Good morning, Austin Oaks. Good morning, church family. It's so good to have you in the house of God this morning. Are you ready to worship with us this morning? Would you just stand on your feet and let's worship Jesus this morning? unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Sing hallelujah, hallelujah, God above it all. Hallelujah, God unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Oh, oh, hero of heaven,
you conquer the grave.
You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken your Lord. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. Oh, you have done great things. Oh, God, you do great
things. Amen, church. It's good to have you here. So glad you came to join us this morning. Amen. Oh, we worship you, Jesus, this morning. Just take a moment and go before God as we're singing these songs. Just present your heart to Him this morning and tell Him, God, here I am. And I've come to worship you and join with the angels and join with creation and bring praise to you. Just take a moment and go before God and make that prayer for yourself. Not in a hurry. I'm not in a hurry to go back home. I just want to linger a little bit longer in your presence this morning. Thank you.
the trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in you found.
Yes.
Just in Israel, justness alone.
We sing that verse one more time. When he shall come, every voice.
Oh, he shall come. Every song we could ever sing, worthy of every praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath I live for you. Oh, tell him this morning, tell him this morning, Jesus, the name above. Jesus, the only one
I could ever see,
and worthy of every breath
I could ever
live for you. Only you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we for you.
He's sinking sand.
stand on cross the solid rock you stand. Oh Lord, the ground is sinking sand. Oh Lord, is sinking sand.
Why don't you just go ahead and close your eyes and go before God and use this moment and worship Him in your own words. Tell Him what's coming from your heart, from the depths of your heart.
The price you pay, bearing all my sin and shame, in love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the
God, by raising our voices and journeying with creation and journeying with a song in heaven, singing that you are worthy, Jesus, that you are worthy, Lamb of God, you are worthy. And lifting a song from the depths of our heart, and we're singing to you that you are worthy. Oh, you are worthy, Jesus. We give you all the praise this morning for your presence here, for your presence in our hearts. I love you, Jesus. In your name, amen. Amen.
You may be seated, church. Good morning and welcome to Austin Oaks Church. We are so glad you're here today. And in particular, we want to extend a welcome to our guests that are here. If this is your first time or first few times, we are so thankful to have you here. We want to get to know you as comfortable as you are letting us know to help you on that journey, help you understand what it means to meet, know, and follow Jesus, which is our mission here at Austin Oaks Church. So there's a connection card in the seats in front of you up and down your aisle. You can grab one of those and you can fill it out physically and drop it in one of the offering baskets, the metal boxes on your way out of the sanctuary, or you can scan it. There's a QR code on there and fill that out digitally if that works better for you. And just give us as much information as you're comfortable with, but ultimately ask any questions that you want of how we can help you get connected here at Austin Oaks Church. This is a big week coming up, so there's a few things, announcements I'm going to make, but everything I'm talking about is on the front page of our website. So if you go there, there's a button that talks about announcements, and everything we've talked about is right there, so you can get all the details you need on our website. But this is a huge week, the biggest week in the life of us as Christians. And I think there's a mindset that's really important for us as we walk into Easter. In fact, today is called what we call Palm Sunday. And Palm Sunday is really a reminder of the mistake that believers made back in Jesus' day of what they thought was going to happen in Jesus' life. You lay down palms for a reigning king that was coming in. But in the life of Jesus and in Jesus' kingdom, there's no crown without the cross. And they were looking for someone to come in and conquer and make life great for them here in this world. And Jesus was coming in to offer his life on the cross to make life great for all eternity, for all peoples. And so as we walk into this, there's a couple of really important events for us. One is Holy Thursday. On Thursday is an event we're going to have here set up on our campus. You can sign up through the website. Again, it's really important you do that. There's limited spaces in this journey that you'll go through lots of different times. But as Christians, it's being mindful that there's no crown without the cross. We are called to pick up our cross here on this earth and give our lives for others. And that's what this week is really about. It's countercultural to everything that you learn in this world. So this is a week to remember that. Remember what Jesus did for you and I, and walk that path behind him on the way to the crown, but never skipping the cross that we have, that he has for us to give our lives for our city and our community. So Thursday, Holy Thursday, sign up. Easter, we have 8:30 and 10:30, so two identical services at both times to make space for everyone. Please come with that mindset. There'll be a lot of guests, and be willing to do whatever it takes to serve our guests and make them comfortable so they can hear the message about Jesus as well. And lastly, what is lastly? Yes, lastly is aware. We have a great opportunity for you to take a three-week class that'll start the week after Easter that really models this. Aware is a class that will help you learn and engage people who are unlike yourself in 3 weeks. I want to just encourage you. I went to a gathering recently, but anyone here know what the largest segment of the growing church is in America? Yeah, if you don't, then this class is perfect for you. It's the immigrant church. The immigrant church is the largest segment of Christianity growing in America right now. And we have an incredible opportunity to be more aware of different people and who they are and engage them and love them and open up a place for them to be part of our church here. And so as we do that, our church can look more like our city and it can look more like the kingdom of God. So we want to challenge you to be part of that. 3 weeks, we're going to talk through how you can do that, how you can learn to engage and understand people different from yourself. Hey, at this time, I'm going to invite you to just stand up or turn and greet the people around you and say, welcome to Austin Oaks Church.
Well, good morning, church family. Just want to introduce myself. I'm Brandon Zissi, lead pastor here at Austin Oaks Church. This is a great morning to be here. In fact, this is just a great morning to be in any church that loves Jesus on this day, because this is Palm Sunday, and I love the way how Chad set it up. This is also a time for us to remember the triumphal entry of Christ. And on this side of Easter, we know what that accomplished. Right? And so this is a time for us to celebrate and to remember what Jesus has done on our behalf. So I want to ask a question, like, who is grateful this morning for the victory that Jesus won on our behalf? Like, there should be no reason for us to be ashamed of celebrating the greatest gift ever given. Right? Like, this is a time for us as a church to almost come in the posture of like David did in the Psalms. Lord, restore unto me the joy of my salvation. And I know that there are some of you in this room that might be needing to pray that prayer. Or maybe you've forgotten the joy of the salvation that Jesus has done, or won, and achieved on our behalf. And so this morning is a great morning. We're going to hear again about the good news of Jesus. This whole week, you're going to hear different aspects of the story that Jesus has done, how he lived it, what he accomplished, and what that means for us. And this morning, we're going to kind of take a different approach on Palm Sunday. Instead of focusing on Jesus coming into Jerusalem, coming into the moment where he had the Passover with his disciples and going to the cross and all that, we're actually going to talk about the mission that's been entrusted to us because of this victory. And so this morning, man, I am beyond excited. It is a joy to have with us a friend and a partner in ministry. His name is Jason Kuhlman, but I want to brag on him a little bit just so you kind of get to know him, because these are things he's not going to say about himself as he introduced. He's going to do the old, here's my wife, here's my kids, all that kind of stuff, which is great. But I want to let you know a little bit about this man. He's a former church planter in Asia, and when COVID hit, they had to leave the country and come back home, and now he is the regional director for STUMO, which is Student Mobilization, which is a parachurch organization. He's a missionary on the college campuses, specifically in Texas and in South Texas, His heart and his task that God has entrusted to him is to develop leaders. And through developing leaders, to multiply disciples. And as we've been saying in our churches, we need to reach the emerging generation so they'd be captivated by Jesus. And I remember once a UN ambassador said that if you want to change the world, you have to change the campus. And so we have with us a great man who God is using significantly to shape a generation. And as I got to know Jason over the previous months and started to kind of like get to know his heart and his passion, Isaiah 26:8 to me is a verse that is just on him. And Isaiah 26:8 says, your name and your renown is the desire of my heart. And friends, that is what Jason Kuhlman lives for. So church, would you please warmly welcome Jason. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, I ask that this morning, what we say to be a church to be simply about Jesus is true in this time. That this isn't about Jason, it isn't about a guest, it isn't about us trying to go, man, who is this guy and what's he saying? Lord, this is a brother in Christ who you've shaped, who you're using. And Lord, at the heartbeat of this, it's about you. It's about reflecting on you, your name, your renown, your glory, your kingdom. And God, I ask that you would use him to feed our hearts, to stir us up, to challenge us, to be mindful of not just the joy of our salvation, but the joy of talking about the salvation. So Lord, I ask that your spirit would anoint him. And God, I pray that you would give us as a church ears to hear. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, church. It's such a joy to be here with you guys. My wife and I and our kids attend Austin Oaks, and so to be able to come in and teach is just a huge blessing for us. Not to, you know, steal Brandon's thunder of my introduction, but here's my family. This is my family, my beautiful wife, Kelsey. She is the queen of our world. She keeps everyone in line. I'm sure there's a lot of those in the crowd keeping families in line, so she was actually out of town the last couple of days, and so I had the kids solo, and so if I look like I just got out of the washer, that's why. Wives have an incredibly hard job, and I got to enter into that solely for a little bit. And so our kids, I wanted to show you guys a little bit of their personality. This is my son, Colt. He is almost 5. I am not a Cowboys fan, but my in-laws are Cowboys fans, so they gave him a shirt, and I'm okay with that because I want my son to know that he can do hard things and that life can be unfair sometimes. So I'm all right with that. This is my daughter, Sailor. She is our little princess. Hey, for anybody out there, no one ever told us to not ever watch Frozen. And so we watched Frozen. Now our whole house is Arendelle all the time. It's all princess dresses. We're good with it, though. But they keep us busy. It's a ton of fun. We love being their parents, and that's our little crew. Whenever I was 7 years old, I published my first book. And so, you know, that's kind of impressive. It was a one-of-one copy, and so there's only one that ever exists. And so I walked into my second grade class, and my teacher said, hey, today you're going to write a book, and the premise of this book is going to be called Someday. And so the idea was that, hey, we want your little 7-year-old mind to think about what you want to be true of your life someday. And so I started writing and drawing, and this was page one. You know, someday I want to be the best soccer player in the world because I want to go to the World Cup. You know, that dream died hard, and it never happened. I wish I could say, hey, here's the picture of me in the World Cup, but it never happened. The next one, someday I want to be the best basketball player on the team. You saw what sports I was good at. I wanted to be the best in the world. Hey, I just want some playing time. You know, it'd just be nice to get some playing time. Most kids, you know, would have drawn that basketball goal right on one of the pages, but I chose the center of the page. I don't know why. You know, creativity. Someday, I want $1 million so I can get a mansion. This is what I thought a mansion was. I don't know. I don't know what's happening with the doors. I don't know why I did that. I didn't know I was going to live in Austin, and it turns out $1 million in inflation, you know, that just doesn't happen. Someday, I want to be a stuntman because everybody will clap for me. Yeah, I was the youngest of three. Oh my gosh, hey. Oh, thanks guys. Wow, it only took 32 years and dreams come true. I was deprived of affirmation apparently. I just needed some affirmation. You know, it's fun to look back at what I thought my purpose would be in life at 7 years old. But you know, as I grew up from really the age 7 to the age 19, my purpose really hadn't changed much in life. I wanted to grow up. I wanted to be the best at whatever I was going to do. I wanted to make money, and I wanted to be celebrated all along the way. And it was that way until I entered into a church and some older men threw their arms around me. And they started challenging me about the purpose of my own life. You see, I believe that we all wrestle with this idea of purpose. The purpose of, hey, why am I created? What is it that I'm really here for? How am I supposed to spend this short time on earth? You know, the human experience is really just the pursuit of mankind trying to satisfy that, trying to figure out. We're purpose cravers. And you know, if we're not careful, what I think can happen is that we can take temporary purpose after temporary purpose and stack it on our life over and over, and at the end of our life, we just call that a life. What I mean is, you know, for some of us, and for me in life, you know, I can have a lot of temporary purposes in life. If you're still in school, you know, we can have a temporary purpose of a GPA that we want to achieve. I never hit that purpose for my own life, but we can have that. If you're playing a sport and you're still in that world, you can want to start for that athletic team, or maybe you just graduated college and you just want to land that first job, or maybe you've been at that job for a little bit and you just want that promotion, or maybe if you're single, you just want to get married, or if you're married, maybe you want to start a family, or maybe if you have a family, you want to or get that 401k up, or if you're retired, maybe you want to travel. And the thing is, guys, is that those aren't bad purposes, but they're temporary. They all have an expiration date. You know, someday you're not going to work that job, and someday you're not going to be in that school, and someday those kids will be out of the house adventuring this world on their own. And if we're not careful, we'll have temporary purpose after temporary purpose after temporary purpose, and we can call that a life. Church, the reason I love this topic is because temporary purposes were never designed to bring long-term satisfaction. Temporary purposes were never designed to bring long-term satisfaction. You know, what if instead of a temporary purpose in life, what if there was a constant? What if there was a never-changing? What if there was a never-ending purpose that God designed for us to give our lives to? What if it was something that was so consistent that it could be your purpose from really young to all the way to the end of your life? What if it could never change based on age, stage, vocation, location, whether I was married, single, whether I had kids? What if God gave us a purpose like that? Let me tell you guys why this is important for your life. Is that we were designed for one purpose. We were designed for one purpose, and you'll either live for it or you'll miss it. We were all designed for one purpose, and this morning I want to invite you to let God define your purpose in life. You see, people who are created, who created things, they get to decide what the purpose is. You know, Steve Jobs, he invented the iPhone, right? We didn't go buy an iPhone and then use it as a boat anchor. Why? Because he said, hey, this is what this is used for. Use it this way. The Wright brothers invented the plane. We didn't take a plane and then put it in the water of a lake to use it as a boat. Why? Because they said, this is what it's used for. You see, God, having designed us, created us, knowing our DNA and what would bring the most purposeful life, he is the one who gets to decide what our life is about. And you see, this purpose, it's so clear in Scripture that it's actually the first command that God gave to mankind. It's the first thing that Jesus said to his disciples whenever he called them to follow him. It's the last thing that Jesus said before he left this world. And it's the culmination at the end of the Bible of heaven of people who had lived for this purpose in their life. You know, we've been studying the book of Revelation. And Pastor Brandon started out by telling us that this book is primarily a book about discipleship. And so, church, I want to invite you guys to explore this with me through the scriptures. If you really want to find your purpose, then you need to multiply by making disciples. If you really want to find your purpose in life, then you need to multiply by making disciples. It was the first command God gave mankind. Go, be fruitful, and multiply. Have you ever thought about, did God just want more people? It's like, no, God wanted people who bared his image to spread out over the world. When Jesus interacted with the first disciples, he said, come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Go, I want more people like me. In Matthew 28, which is the text that we're going to be studying, Jesus, before he left this world, he said, hey, I want you to go and make disciples. And in heaven, it's going to be the culmination of disciples in the kingdom of God, people who loved him and followed him. So how do we do that? How do we multiply? We're going to look at Jesus and his words to define what it looks like to multiply our life. And so we'll be in Matthew 6 or 28, 16 through 20. If you have a Bible, you can turn there. But before we do, I just want us to draw our eyes to the screen of a quote by John MacArthur. And John MacArthur is one of the greatest Bible teachers of our time. And this is what he says about these next four verses. He says, if anyone understands all the rest of the Gospel of Matthew, but he doesn't understand this closing passage, he has missed the point of the entire book. It is not an exaggeration to say that in its broadest sense, it is the focal point of all of Scripture, Old Testament and New. Church, let's lean in. What one of the best Bible teachers of our time is saying is he's saying, if you miss these verses, you'll miss the focal point of the whole Bible. Another way of saying it is if you miss these verses, you can miss your purpose in life. And so with that, a little background on the text that we're going to be looking at. Jesus had just been crucified and rose again. We're going to be celebrating that next week. But before he left and went to heaven, he had a meeting and he gathered a small group of disciples and he wanted to make sure that they understood what their purpose was. You see, when Jesus had died, a lot of them were going back and abandoning their long-term purpose in life. And so Jesus was really wanting to make sure that they knew that what their long-term purpose was. He wanted them to know where they should go from there. He wanted to be sure that they would multiply. This is the text, Matthew 28, 16 through 20. You can follow along. The 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. And so this morning, we're just going to make four observations about this text. The first observation is that your purpose is started in being Christ's disciple. Your purpose is started in being Christ's disciple. You see, verse 16 says, then the 11 disciples. You know, it's really interesting that in the Bible, God could have called his followers anything. Like, he could have called them anything, but he primarily calls them disciples. In fact, the word Christian wasn't even introduced to being called Christ followers. That wasn't even a word that was used until the book of Acts, and it wasn't even anyone that was following Christ that labeled Christians Christians. Isn't that interesting? Everybody would always say, hey, we're just disciples of Jesus. That's what we are. We're his disciples. And I think that's important, especially in the context of this verse, because we've largely gotten away from this word in American Christianity. We usually reference Christ followers in terms like Christians or follower of Jesus or believer, but I think that our purpose is really rooted in the idea of what this word actually meant. And so what is a disciple? That word that Jesus uses for disciple is actually a word called mathetes. And what's interesting is when you hear the word mathetes, is there any English words that you think of that spawn that? Mathematics. And so the very idea of the disciples was this idea that they were going to be people that would multiply their life in another purpose. The exact translation is the word apprentice. An apprentice is someone who really learns from someone to live like someone, to learn from someone, to live like someone. And so when the disciples would have heard that word, or people would have heard that word, it was this idea that people were learning from Jesus to live like Jesus. You know, if I walked into any church, you know, any church in America, and I said, hey, you know, I'm not asking you guys to do this, but I just said, hey, would you stand up if you believe in Jesus? Everyone would stand up. That's why we come to church. But what if we said, hey, are you learning from Jesus to live like Jesus? That hits a little different. Am I right? That hits a little different. Here's the problem. In our culture, a Christian is someone who learns from Jesus. But living like Jesus is optional. It's optional. And guys, it's confusing. It's confusing to the world. It's confusing to the church. There wasn't even a category in the Bible for somebody like that. We were either disciples or not. Our purpose is started in being Christ's disciple, to learn from Christ, to live like Christ. Observation number two, your purpose is rooted in Christ's authority. Your purpose is rooted in Christ's authority. You see what Jesus, or I'm sorry, in verse 18 it says, then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. You see what Jesus is saying by all authority is that he's saying that he has both the right and he has the power to define the purpose of your life. That as your creator, as the person who made you, who knows what you need, he has both the right and the power to define the purpose. And so he's looking at his disciples and he says, hey, you've seen me do a lot of things. And you know that I have both the right and the power to define the purpose of your life. You know, I was dove hunting a couple years ago. I don't know if there's any dove hunters out there, but we're in Texas, so there's probably some. And I love dove hunting. It's a great time. So if you have land and you need a partner, call me. We could go. But I love dove hunting. It's the laziest kind of hunting there is. You go and you sit in a chair with your buddies and you're just kind of talking and the birds literally just fly to you. It's like a magic, you know. And so I was dove hunting a couple years ago and a buddy dropped a pin. He said, we're dove hunting. The dove are flying like crazy. Come to this spot. And so I did. I went there, and I was a little confused because I've hunted in some weird places, but I've never hunted in a place like this. It was a cul-de-sac. We were just in a cul-de-sac, and it was wild. And he's like, yeah, you know, the birds are flying. And so we just literally parked like five trucks around this cul-de-sac. And he wasn't lying. Birds were flying like crazy. And there was like kind of homes that you could see, like not terribly close, but a little bit in the distance, definitely in the same kind of neighborhood that we were in. And so I'm like, I don't know about this, but the birds are flying, you know. So we're just blasting them, you know. It's just a boom, 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 and birds are flying, you know. They're just dropping on the trucks. They're dropping everywhere. They're dropping like manna from the skies of heaven. And it was amazing. Until, out of the peripheral of my eye, I saw sirens. And I just unload the gun, and I just set it down. I'm like, I'm going to jail. You know, Austin statesman, college minister, shoots birds in neighborhood. You know, I'm just waiting for it. And the guy who invited me said, hey, man, just keep, you know, don't worry. Like, just keep shooting. You know, I'm going to go talk to him. So he walks over to him, and he talks to him for a minute. And the police officer, I kid you not, he drives by us and says, good luck, gives us a little honk honk, and just keeps going. And I'm like, what just happened? And so I ask him, I'm like, David, what'd you say? I got to have that in my back pocket for a rainy day, right? You know, like, and he goes, well, Jason, I just told them that I owned all of this. I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, yeah, you know, like I own this, like that land, like I'm developing those houses, like nobody, like this is all mine. You know, it's like Lion King. And I'm like, how far? He's like, as far as the eye can see. I'm like, psh. But it was an amazing moment for me in bringing this specific text alive. Because you see, because David owned that land, he had both the right and he had the power to decide what happened on it. He was the ultimate authority of it. He decided what happened to it. A police officer comes up. I'm thinking, man, that guy's got the authority. He's like, no, this belongs to me. It's all mine. And that's what Jesus is saying. He's saying, I have both the right and the authority to define your purpose. Does Jesus have that kind of authority in your own life? Does Jesus have that kind of authority? And you might be thinking, you know, Jesus doesn't have that kind of authority in my life. And this is his reminder to us, is that he should. But you know how you see someone defines what you're going to do with somebody's command in your life, right? Like how you view a person. And so if we walked out of church and you were walking to your car and, you know, there was a homeless person walking by and they said, hey, hot tip, you should buy Bitcoin today. You're probably going to get in your car and go to lunch and not think much about it. But if you go to lunch and one of your best friends from the church is there and he says, hey, man, I want you to know, hot tip, buy Bitcoin. You're going to probably say, hey, man, I don't know how many articles you've been reading, but like, I don't think that that's going to retire me. But if Warren Buffett calls you today at lunch and he says, hey, hot tip, buy Bitcoin, what do we all do? We sell everything we own and we go in on Bitcoin. Why? Because we believe that Warren Buffett has both the right and the authority to give that command. You know, the problem is oftentimes in life we view Jesus more like the homeless man than we do like Warren Buffett. It's optional. Your purpose is rooted in Christ's authority. Observation number three, your purpose is lived out by making disciples. Reach and teach. Your purpose is lived out by making disciples. Reach and teach. Verse 19 says this, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So what are we supposed to make? We're supposed to make disciples. So if you have a Bible, circle that word or underline that word, make disciples, and circle the word baptize. And you know, the best way to summarize what does it mean by baptize is it means that we are leading people to faith, that we lead people to Christ. You know, our purpose is not found primarily in just taking people that are Christians and helping them become better Christians. Our primary purpose in this world is to go in and be salt and light, to be salt and light to community, to our businesses, to our neighborhoods. And it's to represent Christ and use words to help people come to know Jesus. It's to help baptize. It's interesting how there's a mind shift for me whenever I realize that the primary way that God wanted me, or the primary way that God wanted to see my family, my neighbors, and my coworkers come to Christ was through me. That was a different mentality for me. And the primary way God wants to reach your neighbors, the way he wants you to reach your friends, and the primary way he wants you to reach your family is through you. It's a part of our purpose. But I know what you guys are thinking. You're like, man, I just really don't want to be that guy. You know, like, I don't want to be that girl. I don't want to be that neighbor. I don't want to be that family member. And I get it. That sounds terrifying. You know, I wanted to show this image of my great uncle. His name's Alfred Nafe. He was stationed on the USS Meredith during World War II, and he's a hero in our family. Because one night there was an attack on his ship, and 59 men went into the water of the Pacific that night, many of them wounded, injured, bleeding. Well, as people were in the water and it was frantic, he decided that his job was to help save as many men as possible. And so he went into the water, and because there was blood in the water, there were sharks circling rafts, there were sharks circling him, but man after man, he would grab them and he would put them in the raft, and then he would go back and grab them and put them in the raft, man after man, defending against all threats. I never got to meet my great uncle. He died of exhaustion that night, drowned in the Pacific. And our family received the Purple Heart on his behalf. But the way that I know that story is when I was 12 years old, I went to a museum where they were honoring his life, and man after man after man came up and he said, let me tell you what your uncle did for me. At risk to his own life, because he was afraid, but at risk to his own life, he was courageous to enter into my life and save me and put me on that raft. Another man would come up and say, hey, in spite of that, he put me in the raft. He put me in the raft. Guys, in all the years I've told that story, you know how many people have ever heard the conclusion of it and said, man, I would never want to be that guy? No one. We're inspired to be that guy. We want to be that guy because in spite of fear, threats, he was courageous to give men an extra 75 years. Man, what are we willing to do as a church body who says that we have the hope of eternity to enter into people's lives, to give them that? So evangelism is the first step in making disciples. But it doesn't stop there. If we're actually to see someone come to Christ, what do we do then? The verse goes on to verse 20, and it says, in teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. In teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. If you have a Bible, go ahead and just circle the idea of teaching, and out to the side just write, or teaching them to obey, and then out to the side just write the word teach. You see, we're saved in a moment, but we mature in Christ over a lifetime. You know, there's one moment where we become a Christian, where Jesus' good news of his life, death, and resurrection become real to us, and we say, yes, I want to follow that. But over time, we mature over a lifetime. And I love what John Piper says here. He says, people need to become Christians, and they need to be taught how to think and to feel and to act as a Christian. That is a disciple. This is my friend Brian Smith. Brian, I met whenever I was 19 years old. Brian actually knocked on the door of my fraternity, and he said, hey, I'm here to know if any guys are interested in doing a Bible study. And I said, hey, man, I don't know if you know this, but that's not why we joined this place. And he's like, yeah, you know, but maybe someone will come. And I'm like, I'll go, you know, like, poor guy. Like, no one's going to show up to this thing. And I go. I remember Brian taking me to Goldie's Burger Joint and sharing the gospel with me because he knew that his purpose in life was to multiply. After Brian challenged me to follow Jesus, he began teaching me all about the Christian life. I was a sponge. I wanted to know what it meant to be a disciple. You see, Brian taught me to think like a Christian. I had all kinds of questions. How can the Bible be trusted? You know, what happens to the person that lives on an island that's never heard about the good news of Jesus? What does the Bible say about alcohol? What does it say about all these things? Brian, I don't know. And Brian would lovingly take me to the Bible. And he'd say, well, let's look. Brian taught me how to think like a Christian. He taught me to see how my friends, not just as a bunch of guys having fun in college, but a bunch of guys looking for purpose in all the wrong places. But Brian didn't just teach me to think like a Christian. Brian taught me to feel like a Christian. I don't know about you guys, but I really struggled to believe that God could forgive someone like me. I mean, I've done some really, really messed up things in life. And Brian brought me to the Word, and he showed me that because of who Jesus is, this is how God views you. You are loved. You are created for a purpose, that he delights in you. He doesn't just love you. He likes you. Brian taught me to see myself as God sees me because of Jesus. But Brian didn't just teach me to think like a Christian. He didn't just teach me to feel like a Christian. He taught me to act like a Christian. Brian taught me how to share the good news of Jesus with people in a relatable way that wasn't threatening, but was relational. He taught me about forgiveness. I came from a family where me and my dad, we were just at odds, and whenever I was in college, we hadn't talked for a year, and it was just a broken relationship. He was wondering if we were ever going to be reconciled. I was wondering if that would ever happen, and he pushed me because of the gospel, that because Jesus forgave me, that I can forgive. He didn't just teach me to think like a Christian. He didn't just teach me to feel like a Christian. He taught me to act like a Christian. He didn't just reach me. Brian taught me. And here's the thing, church, is that we all need a Brian in our life. We all need a Brian in our life. And we all need to be a Brian to someone. We need a Brian in our life, and we need to be a Brian to someone. Your purpose is lived out by making disciples reach and teach. The first point is your purpose is continued through Christ's presence. Your purpose is continued through Christ's presence. Verse 20 goes on and it says, "Surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age." You see, Jesus starts with himself, "All authority in heaven has been given to me. I have the right to define your purpose." And he ends with himself, "Surely I'll be with you to the very end of the age. Hey, I'm not going to abandon you. I will be with you." This isn't a goodbye. It's a, hey, as you go out, I am with you. What Jesus is saying is that living out our purpose as followers of him to multiply by making disciples isn't just hard. It's impossible. It's impossible apart from Jesus. It's not just hard, that it is impossible. You know, my son, whenever he was about this age, my wife took him to a trampoline park. And she took him to this trampoline park, and I said, you know, she came home, and I said, "Babe, how was it?" And she said, "Well, you know, he was a little young, you know, for like the trampoline park to engage in all the activities." I'm like, "What do you mean he was young?" And she's like, "Well, you know, he went to the basketball goal, but he couldn't really get the ball, like, to the goal. You know, there's other kids that are like jumping and dunking, and he's just too small." And so he goes to the dodgeball, sees all the kids playing dodgeball, and man, like, he was just too small. He's just a target, right? Like, he's just going to get smoked. And so I'm like, "Oh, yeah, you know, I could see that." And she's like, "Well, you know," and then there's this like big foam platform that kids can climb up and jump off of, but you have to be a certain height. And so, you know, he really couldn't just engage the environment. And as a dad, something inside of me was growing. And I was like, "Man, not for my son." So the next morning, I'm like, "Clear the schedule. We're going back to the trampoline park." So I take my son and we walk in, and you know, it's like a movie. Smoke's coming out. We kick in the doors. It's slow. I'm just kidding. We didn't do that. But we walk in and we go over to the basketball court. And I say, "Son, do you want to dunk?" He's like, "Yeah, I want to dunk." And I'm like lifting him up, and he's hanging on the rim like Shaq. You know, it's amazing. I put him on my shoulders and I'm bouncing up and down. He's swatting guys at the rim, you know, this little three-year-old. We go to the dodgeball pit, and I'm like, I'm just guarding him, you know, it's protection. And there's that one kid that, you know, whose parents just don't want to watch him, and he's the bully, and he's just trying to chunk it at us, and so I just smoked him with the ball. We go over to the foam pit, there's a high school kid working, right? And he's looking at me, and I'm looking at him, and he's looking at the high sign, and we both know what's about to happen. This is going to happen. And I pick him up and I throw him in, and he's loving it and just landing. And we come home and my wife says, "Babe, how'd it go?" Colt's like, "It was amazing. It was the time of my life. I had so much fun." What was different? Same experience. Same moments. But I was with him. It changed everything. That's what Jesus is saying about the Great Commission. I'm with you. You can do things that you never imagined you could do. You can walk into your business and start that Bible study. You can invite that family down the street to your kitchen table. You can engage that conversation with the person that you don't know if they follow Jesus and talk to them about Jesus. You know why you can do those things? I know it's scary. I know it's hard. But you can do it because I'm with you. Your purpose is continued through Christ's presence. Big picture context, Jesus just told these disciples that their purpose is to multiply, and then the book of Matthew ends. It's over. There's no question, no Q&A, no, "Hey, what do you mean?" Because they knew exactly what Jesus meant. They meant that they were to learn from Jesus, to live like Jesus, and to help reach and teach, and they knew that they could do it because Jesus was with them till the very end. See, this is not how the disciples viewed reaching the world. One more slide. This is not how the disciples viewed Jesus or the gospel going forth in the world. Jesus telling the disciples, "Make Christians." and the disciples going out into the world. Had they done that, based on rough calculations, it would have taken about 11,098 years for the gospel to go to the world. That's impossible. That's without sleep, without eating. If they just went nonstop for 12 people based on the world population at that time, it would have taken 11,098 years for the gospel to go across the world. It's not possible. But that's not how they viewed it. You see, making disciples is a possible solution to an impossible task. To take the beauty of the gospel to the entire world. The disciples would have viewed it like this. Jesus says, go and make disciples, reach and teach, 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 reach and teach. You see, through multiplication, the gospel goes forth in the world. That was the original intent. That was always the purpose of the church, to equip the saints for the work of the Lord. What's the work of the Lord, church? Make disciples of all nations for his glory. You see, making disciples isn't just another temporary purpose in life. It's our God-designed purpose from the very beginning. The disciples knew that. That regardless of age and stage, location, vocation, whether they were old or young, rich or poor, for the rest of their lives, they would multiply the kingdom of God. So how do we apply this to our lives as a church? How do we take this message and make tangible decisions this morning to be a person who multiplies by making disciples? Here's three thoughts for you. The first one is latch on to a Brian. Latch on to a Brian. Guys, our church is big. It's big. And it can be intimidating trying to find someone who can disciple or mentor us in the faith. And so I want you to think in terms of program to people. From program to people. Man, we have incredible discipleship groups in this church. They're amazing. We have Re-Engage. If you're a married couple and you're looking to re-engage in your marriage, if that's an area that you need to be discipled in, it'd be an incredible place. We have men's groups, women's groups. If you want other men in your life, other women in your life, that's an amazing group. But when you get in that group, look for a person. Look for a person. Look for somebody in that group that you say, man, I see God in your life. And then take a risk and walk up to that person and say, hey, I see Jesus in you. Would you invest in me? Would you invest in me? If someone asks you to invest in your life, I hope that you would be open to that. That you'd be open to meeting with them and investing your life there. I think it'd be a huge blessing. And I think you would feel the purpose of your life increase by doing that. The second one is engage a mission field. Engage a mission field. There are countless places in the city of Austin that need men and women like you advancing the kingdom of God. Now that word go, in therefore go make disciples, it actually means, hey, as you are going. So as you're going about your life, as you are doing life, make disciples. So I'm not asking you to go someplace that you haven't been. We're talking about places that as you go, where are places that you go? Maybe it's your business, maybe it's your neighborhood, maybe it's your gym, maybe you work remote at a coffee shop. Wherever it is, as you go, define an area that you want to see God raise up a disciple and begin praying for it. Pray that God would use you in that way. And right now, I want us each just to think in our mind of, hey, who are one to two people that we don't know if they follow Jesus? Like, we don't know, but like, hey, it's somebody in my neighborhood or it's a friend, you know, that I don't know if they know Jesus. What if we took a step of faith and we invited them to Easter next Sunday? Easter is a naturally, spiritually interesting time for people, especially people that don't have a home church or don't have a church or don't go to church. And so just call them up and here's a line that you can use. If you're not going anywhere for Easter, I'd love for you to come with me next Sunday. That's it. Super simple. Hey, if you're not going anywhere next week, would you come with me? And if they don't come, maybe we could bring Easter to them. Maybe something that Pastor Brandon says next week strikes a chord in your heart and you can say, hey, you know, we missed you at church. Something that really stuck out to me was this. Third thought, take a step to grow in evangelism. Take a step to grow in evangelism. There's a quote I read recently that really knocked the spiritual breath out of me. It says, lost people are more amazed at our silence than offended by our message. That's heavy. Lost people are more amazed about our silence than they are offended by our message. That was Professor Alvin Reed. Guys, the world is hurting. I don't have to tell you guys that. The world's hurting. You walk out the doors and the world's confused. There's pain, there's anxiety, there's fear. The world is hurting, but we have a message about a man named Jesus who came and lived a perfect life, died and was resurrected, and that those who follow him can find peace, joy, and hope in a lost and broken world. We got to grow in our ability to talk about that. There's a book called Beyond Awkward. If you're looking to grow in that, there's a book called Beyond Awkward I'd recommend. It's a great book on evangelism. But one of the premises is that people who want to know more about Jesus feel awkward asking about Jesus. And people who know a lot about Jesus feel awkward talking to them about Jesus. And so there's a standoff. I want to ask about Jesus. I don't know if you want to hear about Jesus. And he talks about this premise called that we need to be able to pay the awkward tax. Hey, it's awkward, but as a believer who believes in the hope of the kingdom to come, I am going to pay that tax. If you like that premise, I'd encourage you to check out that book. It's on the screen. In 1930, there was a man named Dawson Trotman. You know, coming out of high school, he was a student body president. He was valedictorian. Whenever he graduated from high school, he forewent going to college and decided to work in a lumber yard. In the lumberyard, Dawson Trotman basically did what most, you know, 19 to 22-year-olds were doing. He was gambling. He was going to the local pubs. He was over drinking. And one night, he went to the fair with his friends, and after getting drunk, he was stumbling to his car. Whenever a police officer walks up and sees him getting into his car, he handcuffs him, puts him on the side of the curb. And in that moment, that police officer saw something in Dawson's life that was painful. And so he looked him in the eyes and he said, son, do you like this life? And he said, no, I hate it. Well, that encounter over the next few weeks, Dawson Trotman opened his Bible. He ended up finding Christ through some men and women in his church. And he began devouring the Bible. He started studying all the scriptures. And he's like, man, I want to know about this life, this new life that Jesus promises. And he came across the end of the book of Matthew, Matthew 28, verse 16 through 20. And he decided that his purpose in life was to multiply by making disciples, regardless of his age, stage, where he was. He wanted that to be a driver in his life. The reason I tell you guys that story is because Dawson Trotman, he died in 1956. But before he did, he made a disciple. He reached and taught a man named Lauren Saney, who made a disciple of a man named Gene War, who made a disciple of a man named John Repass, who made a disciple of Dan Williams, who made a disciple of Harold Armstrong, who made a disciple of Robert Wheelis, who made a disciple of Brandon Grissom, who made a disciple of a man named Brian Smith. You guys remember who knocked on my door whenever I was 19? Brian Smith. Do you see the picture, church? Almost 100 years of men, some lawyers, some real estate agents, some pastors, some musicians, regardless of age, stage, they were investing what the gospel had done in their life and taking it and passing it on. That's the picture of the kingdom of God growing in this world. That's why it's our purpose. I want to invite you guys this morning to align your purpose with God's purpose. I want to invite you to take a step to engage in multiplying by making disciples, and that we would be a church that doesn't just meet here, but we would be a church that takes the kingdom of God out there. Let me pray for us. Father God, we come before you, and I just thank you for your word. I thank you, God, that you designed us with this desire for purpose, that we crave purpose. God, I confess in my own life that there's so many areas, so many things, so many temporary purposes that I just want to give my time, my talent, my energy to. Father, just that I think like Solomon will solve this heart issue in me. But God, time and time again, it doesn't. And so I just pray for our church. I pray, Father, that the goal of being of finding our purpose in making disciples and multiplying that in our city, in our neighborhood, in our state, in this world, would usher in a kingdom of God. And as we study the book of Revelation, God, may we take heed of the seven churches that had discipleship gaps, and would we be teachable to those gaps in our own life. God, would you do an amazing work through this church, through these people, and next week, Father, as we celebrate the resurrected Lord, thank you for the goodness of the gospel, that you didn't just save us, that you saved us for something, and that's ushering in your kingdom. We love you, and we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let me invite you, church, to stand on your feet and join us as we respond to this message. Let me invite the prayer team as well to step in front. And if you're here and you need prayer, I will invite you as well to, you know, during this song, come and find somebody. They'll be on the left and the right, and they'll be ready to pray for you.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. And worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, live for you. Your heart and me. open up my eyes in awe. Show me who you are. And lead me in love to those around me.
Hey, church, this is formally the end of our time to worship together, but two things take place during this time that are really important. One is our prayer team will continue to be up here up front, and I know a lot of people are still just having someone tug on their heart to just be prayed for, and so we want to keep that space available for you up front. And we also want you to be able to fellowship and connect with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ as we continue. So if you could do that towards the back of the sanctuary or out in the great foyer spaces we have, that would allow this space to be continue to be a spot for prayer as our worship team will continue praying and singing over us as we go. So you're dismissed. Have a wonderful Sunday, and we're excited for Easter coming up this week.